Blackstone Publishing presents Cat Got Your Crown, a Kitty Couture mystery by Julie Chase. This book is read by Brittany Pressley. Chapter 1. Furry Godmother's Words of Warning. Beware of showboats. Sometimes they splash. Excitement charged the air inside the historic Sanger Theater on Canal Street. The atmospheric interior had been designed to replicate a 15th-century Italian courtyard, complete with inky-domed ceiling and starry sky. I wasn't sure about Italy in the 1600s, but in modern-day New Orleans, the venue was packed to the pylons with 100 highly trained pets and their anxious handlers. Judges, staff, and volunteers for the National Pet Pageant scampered through the crowded hallways, finalizing details for Tuesday's big show. I was doing my best to answer questions, adjust and repair the performers' costumes, and stay out of the way.
Lacy!
An austere woman wearing a tweed skirt and a deep frown headed my way.
Ms. Crocker, a moment, please.
I moved carefully in her direction, keeping a vigilant eye on a pair of stubborn cockatoos flying overhead. The intricately detailed ceiling was widely considered a point of interest, but at the moment, it was unwise to look directly up.
Coming!
The woman met me several feet from her assigned table and led me back to a growling cat in a bedazzled carrier. She pinched a battered bonnet between her fingers. The frilly eyelet material had come loose at the seams, and one row of ruffles had nearly been chewed off.
Can you fix it?
Of course. As the unofficial costume department, I was determined to fix everything. It's no problem.
I don't know what's gotten into her,
the woman said.
Maybe it's the weather, or the full moon. This city is strange. Have you seen the cemeteries? Everyone's buried above ground. Is that even natural? And have you taken the ghost tour?
She stroked one long finger against a narrow eyebrow and grimaced.
Jackie and I will be glad to return home to Dallas, where everything is normal.
I opened my jumbo-sized pink tackle box and selected the best tool for the job. I'm sure it's just nerves.
There are too many tourists in this town, and people in costumes for no apparent reason. A man was playing bagpipes outside my hotel this morning.
I threaded a needle and smiled. Personally, I loved my city, but I could see how someone wearing a bun tight enough to cause a migraine might be put off. I gave her cat a warm smile. Rehearsal for an event this big would rattle anyone. Right, Jackie? The National Pet Pageant was a traveling talent competition for four-legged friends and winged companions. The event was hosted by a different city around the country each year, and thanks to the dedicated petitioning of my mother, this year the producers had chosen New Orleans. The NPP, as my mom called it, was the rough equivalent of Miss Universe, or maybe the Olympics for pets. A lot of money and media attention awaited the winners and their owners on the other side. I set the final stitch and snapped the thread with my hands. A quick snip of the hanging ends and voila. There you go. The strings and lace are back in place. You'll want to rinse the bonnet tonight and let it dry on a bed knob to help with its shape. I opened the sparkly carrier and lifted Jacqueline Tabby Onassis into my arms.
Hello, gorgeous.
I stroked her fur and rubbed her ears before securing the little chin strap and fluffing the material. What do you think? I turned the gray and white kitty to face her owner. She blinked big green eyes and yawned. The woman heaved a sigh.
Bless you.
She stuffed Jackie back into her carrier, sans bonnet, and fixed me with a pointed stare.
This is exactly why everyone says Furry Godmother is the best. You absolutely are.
I appreciate that, thank you. Furry Godmother was the name of my pet boutique, an organic treat bakery on Magazine Street. I'd opened my doors a year ago at the heart of New Orleans' famed Garden District. In the time since, I'd made a name for myself with locals and pet enthusiasts alike. The latter enjoyed spoiling their fur babies with my treats and designs. The former recognized my name from its repeated appearance in newspaper articles on various crimes. I was prouder of one of those facts than the other. Which one depended on the day. I tossed the needle and remaining thread back into my tackle box. Let me know if there's anything else I can do. I swept a mass of sticky hair into a loose ponytail and checked my watch. 10 minutes until lunch, and I was already dreaming of fresh air and cold water.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.